Welcome to Ridge Riders. I'm in Hampshire. No, I'm in Wiltshire. Actually, I'm right smack on the border. How do I know? Well, this is the old Red Lion pub. It's in the historic village of West Dean, and the border runs straight away through the lounge. It's a private house these days. I wonder who they pay their rates to. Anyway, it goes back to Jacobean times and well beyond.
Today's ride into Hampshire and Wiltshire visits, amongst other historic sites, a Saxon moot or parliament. So we have three special motorbike riders from today's moot at Westminster. Hazel Blears MP, Salford, Labour. Julian Lewis MP, New Forest East, Conservative. And Lucius Edward William Plantagenet Carey, the Viscount Falkland, whose family came over with the Conqueror, settling up for the Lib Dems. Four riders, five bikes. We've got a spare today, with classics like a 50s Beezer Bantam, a rare 51 Sunbeam S7, and a splendidly restored 1938 Rudd Special. But it's the latest thing for Hazel.
That's more like it. I think I can be in charge of this little monster, I think. Could certainly do me for the day.
So it's new for Labour then, is it?
New, modern. Accessible, inclusive.
Next to the former pub is the bridge over the River Dun, where once the old canal from Salisbury to Southampton ran. It was dug in 1795, but was a disaster from the word go. It was closed after just 5 years and has now disappeared. Our route today traces parts of the Lymington and South Hampshire ridgeways, the ancient high roads travelled by our ancestors. From West Dean we go up to a 400-year-old folly, meet at the Moot in Downton, look at Roman New Forest pottery, search for a lost castle above the River Avon, and end up at Bremer. In the year 1100, the Ridgeway saw the body of King William Rufus carried along here to lay in state at Winchester. He was shot whilst hunting in the New Forest, and his death is still a bit of a whodunit. Was it an accident or assassination? Very little of this ancient Ridgeway is rideable today. Most of our journey will be on country lanes, but here, one of us could take a drove road up to the ridge top.
Who's any good at off-roading skills? Are you any good at off-roading?
Never done it in my life.
Any done any off-roading?
Well, not much.
Because you were the last one to switch off the engine, it seems you've been volunteered to do some off-roading.
Right, OK.
Lucky Lucius. This track was a route down into the valley for travellers and drovers over thousands of years, and it's still one of the very few byways open to traffic. This valley was once dotted with the villas of well-to-do Romans. Peter Saunders of Salisbury Museum tells us about the view from the ridge.
It's a lovely spot, this, Nick. And as you can see in the far distance, you've got Salisbury Cathedral and Longford Castle away there over in the distance. As you come round, Clarendon Park and Clarendon Palace in the woods there. But particularly today, I want to show you the Roman sites, which are down in the valley here. East Grimstead, the village, West Dean, all on spots where there were Roman villas. They came over in AD 43, but they wouldn't have settled here perhaps until the end of the first century.
No.
And then the sites, the villas that we know here from around here, date from around the 4th.
So several generations of families would have lived
and certainly, certainly the villas down in the valley here, quite wealthy, with Roman hypocausts, bathhouses, quite wealthy landowners.
Yeah, interesting.
So why did they choose here?
Well, I think they decided to make their pottery and industrial processes in the New Forest, but they decided that the land here was much more gentle, undulating as it is today, easier to farm, plentiful supply of water, plentiful supply of timber from the forests, and so all the raw materials for life. And you know, on a nice day like this, who wouldn't choose such a spot?
That's true.
Peter has some of the Romans' lost property from his museum.
This is an early brooch, and it comes from West Dean. You can see it's very much like a safety pin. It's still got the pin on the back there that works.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Hazel, if we could pop that on you, and you'd be looking very smart.
Make quite a mess in your blouse, though, that pin, wouldn't it?
Well, it would if you were wearing a blouse, but yes. I suspect you'd have been wearing a rather glorious toga or a cloak.
Gorgeous, gorgeous. I'm there, transported.
And then perhaps, if you'd got a bit longer hair, you'd have had a hairpin. It's made of bone. Nice little carved head to it there. but that would have gone through a ribbon or something in your hair. And then that, I'm sure you can recognise, the handle is actually partly broken off, but can you see, that's a very beautiful spoon.
That is
typical Roman shape. And what they usually do is to eat things, obviously, with the spoon, with the bowl of the spoon, and then the handle usually has a point, and they use that to get the fish out of its shell, perhaps a whelk or something like that.
Beautiful.
These were all found when Hayward Sumner was excavating the Roman villas. I've got his one of his publications here, and if I can just read you out the very opening paragraph in the book, it's rather splendid. It says, "Every site has got its best approach, and you'll be pleased, Ridge Riders, that you've actually taken that approach today. And the down track on the eastern crossway should always be followed by the archaeological wayfarer who seeks such an approach to the Roman sites at East Grimstead and West Dean."
So we're on the right track.
So you're on the right track.
The next view to view on the Ridgeway is the one from this mini grandstand known locally as the Pepper Box or Ayers Folly.
What sort of date is this folly?
1606. Giles Ayer built it. And they say that he built it to spy on his neighbours. It's a prime spot for looking out, but not really on neighbours, as they hadn't actually invented the telescope by that stage.
Right. Have you got the key? Are we going to be able to go inside, do you think?
Just so happens, about my person.
I have a huge bunch of keys.
And all we have to do is find the
door.
I think the Honourable Lady is pulling my leg.
So where's the door then?
It's a very good question, actually. I'm a bit worried about the fact that I have a key and I don't have
a door.
This is like one of those programmes, isn't it, where you compete to find a treasure somewhere with a key which doesn't fit, a door which doesn't exist.
You could write a book about this. People are coming here trying to get inside the treasure that isn't there anymore.
Go on, let's go round one more time.
One more time? Okay.
There is no door on any of its eight sides. And I'm looking foolish at the folly.
Plenty of follies in my family, and skeletons, I can tell you.
Wouldn't any of your ancestors barking mad? Because there's usually one in the family.
Oh, yes. Well, barking mad, but certainly on the edge.
It's all relative.
It's all relative, yes. My great-great-grandfather was killed in a duel, which he was the author of his downfall by insulting quite an acquaintance. He was a naval captain who'd just been given a ship, a large and important 74-gun ship, and he'd been celebrating for some days, and I think his judgment was somewhat impaired. He was probably more of a ruffian than an eccentric, actually. But in the end, he died very gracefully, because he was shot by accident by the man, by ricochet, but when it was his turn to fire back, because he was still standing, he threw the gun away, because he knew perfectly well he was in the wrong. I got that out of the Times account, actually.
Was that right?
Yes.
Where was he shot?
He was shot in the groin, and he took 3 days dying. When you say shot, what do you mean? He was in Chalk Farm, and he was shot in the groin.
No, shot in the groin? I think I'd have probably dropped everything I was holding if I was...
The Pepper Box stands on the highest point of the ridge, and several tracks and drove roads converged here on Witherington Down. We're tracing a Saxon weg, way down to the ford on the Avon that became Downton. Here the Saxons gathered and traded, and at this strategic crossing point the Normans built a motte and bailey castle. In the 18th century it became the formal garden to Moot House, and most of the castle remains were lost. And we're lost as well.
On that bridge?
The motte in the moot is not near the moat.
Well, it's a moot point where the moat ought to be.
It looks vaguely like the motte.
Well, I believe we've come across this path, so it ought to be somewhere off to the right, which I might guess is up there.
That thing there, then?
Mm-hmm.
How about that? Okay. You look like you're under arrest. Just avoiding the nettles.
You're the jungle.
Downton itself was very important because it was the point at which the Ridgeway had to ford across the Avon. And so that was used by the Saxons as the site where they would have one of their hundreds moot, and the hundreds being like a sort of local district council.
And the motte is the bit we're standing on, isn't it? Which is the Norman motte, which is meant the bit in the middle that they used to...
Yes. As we were saying on the way up, there's not a lot of motte to be seen. But in fact, there are references to all this going back in the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle for 1137, where it says that for every great man built him castles and held them against the king, and they filled the whole land with these castles. They sorely burdened the unhappy people of the country with forced labour.
But no minimum wage.
And when the castles were built, they filled them with devils and wicked men. So whether we really like that comparison with our modern local government, I'm not quite certain.
The moot gardens are now open to the public, and a trust is setting about restoring the site. Part of it looks like the green benches of the House of Commons. Order! Order!
Give way!
I think the Honourable Gentleman should keep his silence.
Yeah.
Resume his seat.
I'm not making any impression. I'm obviously back in the cheap seats.
When judges sat on the bench.
A member of the general public. No say in the matter.
Some people would say judges talk a lot.
Mute rather than moot.
There's no stopping them once they get started, is there? Back in the saddle and back on the Ridgeway, the Lymington Ridgeway now, and back in time about 3,000 years on the edge of the New Forest and a lump in the corner of Hale Village Green.
So I thought I'd try something
Great.
Different.
It's very exciting.
Okay, RidgeRiders, this is the spot. So, what do you reckon this is?
Looks like a burial mound of some kind.
Very good, yes, a Bronze Age burial mound.
Oh, right.
And the dimple in the middle is because, anyone has a guess?
No idea.
Because it's been raided, basically, because people thought there would be treasure in it and they dug all the middle out. And around here they're referred to as hats, or butts, or balls. Interestingly, around here it's known as Windmill Ball, and the reason was because they say that a windmill was on it, though not the big sort of windmill we see today.
No.
The type of medieval windmill. So that would suggest that it's been robbed since medieval times. Right.
Yes, sure.
So at some stage this would have been a place of some reverence and quiet, where they'd have buried some local warlord or chieftain. Now it's right next to the road and outside somebody's bedroom window. I wonder whether they know that they're living outside a graveyard.
The New Forest isn't just a forest of trees, but huge tracts of open heathland as well. And out in the open, it's easy to see that the main roads through the forest are all on ridgeways. We leave the Lymington Ridgeway, known less romantically today as the B3080, and turn onto the Hampton Ridge. The empty heathland between the two ridgeways was in Roman times the site of the largest pottery industry in Britain, where you can still find bits of 2,000-year-old pottery lying about. Tony Jocelyn of Black Lane Pots makes facsimiles of ancient pottery for museums and has reproduced some Roman New Forest ware for us.
They did two sorts of pots. One was, this was probably for domestic use, probably for olives or something like that. And what they used to do is to cut off all the air holes in the kiln when the stuff was being fired, which meant for the flames to breathe, it changed the nature of the clay and made it black. This is why we see such a lot of black, black Roman pottery. A centre like this would be looking for contracts to the Roman army or the Roman armies, various regiments. That's where they get their big money in. And they'd sell right the way up to London, across the south coast.
I try and imagine. It looks like a jug, actually, doesn't it? It would have been a jug, and perhaps it would have had oil in it, and perhaps ladies would have used it in their Roman bath or something like that, do you think? Do you want to touch that and feel it, see what you can get from it?
I think it's just amazing if you look out across that valley and you can imagine, if you picture all the kilns smoking away and people hauling clay backwards and forwards, and when you look at it now, there's nothing there, is there?
About 1,000 years after the pottery industry died, another industry sprung up, smuggling. It's said that half the luxury goods sold in England then were duty-free contraband. Smugglers' hidden paths crisscrossed the forest, which was a haven for outlaws. Cue for a song from Ashley Hutchings, Phil Beer and Chris Weil.
Welcome to the Smuggler's Road. Duty-free, it is our code. Travel freely, out of sight, under the cover of the night. But if you use your chance to hear the sound of hooves approaching near, to your fellows a warning shout, the excise man is about. Travelling down the smuggler's road with our precious branded load. Duty free, it is the cry from the people passing by. But if in a forest dark, you should hear the crunch of a car or some voices ringing clear. Turn your head away. To gain and none to pay. Lace and silk, tobacco and tea, none to carry more than we. Many choose the smuggler's life, cheating sides when it is arrived. They call it contraband from the sea, we call it duty free.
The dense forest could have hidden many a smuggling gang from the excise men. Today it hides the remains of an ancient fortification. What looks like just a steep slope and a small clearing reveals much more to the trained eye. Local historian Anthony Light has just such an eye.
We're in the middle of really a 12th century castle, a fort. The trouble is that we don't actually know anything about it. It's not recorded in any way. And then the whole thing is complicated by the fact that the whole of the 12th century fort is built on an Iron Age fort that probably dates from a few hundred years BC.
If it's not recorded, what's the evidence that you can see and touch and feel?
Basically, the plan. Here you've got the original keep where there would have been probably a wooden castle. These are the outer baileys. There are actually two of those which would have had support buildings where the stores would have been kept. The tower itself will only have accommodated a guard. You know, we're not talking of huge garrisons at this stage.
So it's an observation tower, really.
It's a semi-permanent observation tower.
Because that's not going to withstand any siege,
not at all. Yeah, I mean, if we could take these trees away, we'd have a wonderful view all down the valley in both directions. You would have a very good strategic point on this side of the valley for anyone coming up.
It's all very strange. A temporary fort put up here 800 years ago. No written evidence that it existed, but it's still called Castle Hill. The locals did have long memories. A little further along the escarpment, a gap in the trees reveals why the Celts built forts up here. They guarded the border along the river between two tribes, the Durotriges and the Atrabates, just over 2,000 years ago. The Rudge is not at all well. Its ridges run. I knew that spare bike would come in handy. So we reshuffle the transport portfolio. After the Romans pulled out, the south was up for grabs 1,500 years ago. We're dropping down to Cerdic's Ford on the Avon. Today it's called Charford, but in 519 AD it was a killing field for the battle between the Romano Celts and the invading Anglo-Saxons led by warrior king Cerdic.
A later chronicler wrote, "A great blow had fallen on the dwellers of Albion, and greater yet had it been but for the sun's going down. 'Tis said that 5,000 men were slain that day." The Celtic king Naton Laud was slain at the battle. An 18th century map marked the area as the Bloody Marshes. Such was the folk memory of the carnage brought by the invading Saxons. With the victory, the lineage of the kings of Wessex was founded. Mm. There you are.
All happened here in this quiet little board. Mm,
yeah. The Bloody Marshes, you can imagine them, the river sort of running with people's blood.
The Bloody Marshes were drained long ago, and we're taking the easy route across the Avon and climb onto the chalk downland above Bremer. For 6,000 years, man has been leaving his mark here on the Downs with hill forts, barrows, dikes, and the ancient and mysterious Mismay's labyrinth.
There are about half a dozen in the country, that's all. And basically, they're the kind of maze that you can't get lost in because there's only one way in and one way out, and it's a turf maze. And apparently, they were built sort of for monks who'd committed terrible sins. And in order to pay penance, they were made to shuffle along through the maze on their hands and knees, which sounds dreadful. And that was perhaps to illustrate that the road to paradise is a very difficult road to follow, unless you are pure in heart and spirit.
Yeah. I was just wondering whether the road to Parliament was quite so difficult.
It's not on your hands and knees, that's on your tummy.
Amazing. It's time for tea, and the end of the day's run finds us at the family seat of an old friend of Lord Falkland's, Bremer House, the home of Sir Edward Hulse. The estate's been in the Hulse family for nearly 300 years. The Saxon church had already been here 600 years when the Elizabethan house was built in 1583. There was a bad fire in Victorian times, but the house has remained very much as it was when good Queen Bess came to call.
Wow. Which we thought would be appropriate.
Sir Edward joins us on the south terrace for a Tudor repast of cordials and Lenten pie.
Which is salmon and pears and raisins and cinnamon and all kinds of lovely things. So let's find out how you felt about the day. Let's start with you, Hazel. Did you enjoy your day?
Thoroughly. I've really enjoyed myself. I'm quite pleased that I managed the bike all day without having an accident, without falling off. And I really enjoyed meeting the potter. I thought he was really interesting. Doing something now that was done sort of thousands of years ago and recreating it now was really good.
I haven't enjoyed a day so much for a long time. The bikes were absolutely wonderful. I only wish that I'd be able to stay with the Rudge all day and that my jinx with electrics hadn't affected it.
Julian, you tried every bike in the end, didn't you?
Well, most of them, yes. And although it was very nice to get on these veteran machines, the invention of the electric start was a definite step forward.
Something of a step forward.
In the progress of mankind and civilization in general. And for me, of course, to spend part of the day on the superb, brilliant and incomparable New Forest. Well, what more can I say?
So that was your favourite bit, was it?
It has to be.
Okay, well, I'm going to get stuck in. I'm going to have to use the spatula, it looks like. So I'll probably best to say goodbye now before it gets ugly. But next time, join us again because we're heading for the Isle of Purbeck for a ride along the South Dorset Ridgeway. Cheerio.